Hi everybody, I'm Stuart Russell and welcome to the next installment in our Future Tech series of presentations where we get a variety of different experts together on the virtual sofa and ask them to talk about what is going on in their world in terms of trends and issues. And today we are all about the newsroom. The contemporary newsroom is often a hive of activity, but the ongoing COVID pandemic has obviously dramatically affected news providers and the way that they work. To join us today to dig into the details and ponder the problems are the fantastic Carol Pijard, who is Business Development Manager for News Workflows at Ross, and everyone's favourite alternative fact, Mr. Jack Horry, who is Product Specialist for Automation and Control. Welcome to you both. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
So first question, I guess, to get us started, in terms of customers and partners, and I know you're both often speaking to both customers and partners, what are the trends that we're seeing in the modern newsroom?
Well, I mean, the trends have started from COVID, really, at the moment. Everything is going into small little boxes. And everything is starting to feel like a Zoom or a Teams call. And although that has lasted us for the 6 months of lockdown, production is demanding that we need to be better than that. So it's not even the souped up Zoom or Teams call. We need to actually go back to being a production and framing cameras in a way that actually feels like it's a premium product again. And utilizing the cameras and the sound in the same way. I know that the main control rooms of some of them have been deserted. Some of them have turned into remote palaces of control. and there's been various different levels of what customers are seeing as the minimum viable product. I hate that word. It's a really horrible sentence to come up with, but it the pandemic has definitely sort of changed people's perceptions of what that is.
Carol, does your experience reflect that as well?
Yes, some trends were starting before the COVID, but just have been accelerating during this period, especially, for example, the cloud and SaaS model, more especially the SaaS model, because these days it's harder to do on-site installation, to even work on-site. So clearly we have seen a lot of more interest into SaaS and cloud. And the fact that people can go online and order anything and start and end when they want, that's really something we have seen evaluating, especially for live and sports, because it has been really hard for them to plan anything. Dates are changing. Football season are starting or ending in some countries. So they're really looking at something really flexible to restart the season. And they have been really in demand of the SaaS and cloud offer, just to at least fit these demands on changing the schedule.
And you mentioned SaaS and cloud. I mean, are those the two main technologies that newsrooms are now looking at? Or are there other things there catching
well,
people's attention?
I think to start with, people are trying to maximize what they already have. So even if there is no SaaS or cloud model, they're trying to add on things to make those work in that sort of scenario. So using things like the sort of remote desktop things to use a graphics machine at base or an audio desk in a way that they don't have to be in the same room is where it started with. So anything that's natively SaaS, and if they can build it into their system without too much change at the moment and too much hands-on on site to implement that, they are trying to do that now.
Carol, your thoughts?
No, I agree with Jack. I don't personally, I've seen mainly these ones for the news aspect, or at least from the journalist part, because most of them could already connect remotely with apps and their system. So really, the change I've seen is more in the technology and the model of the technology, more than the way they were working, because a lot of them were already able to connect remotely to the newsroom on really, again, on the journalist aspect, not on the control room, but I'm talking about the newsroom. So that's really one of the trends that I've seen the most, is the conception and the model behind it.
And I mean, you mentioned earlier on there the idea of minimizing the number of people who are together in a facility. I mean, what other problems would you say broadcasters are facing at the moment in this environment?
I mean, I think the biggest one is we're all at home. We've all got standard internet from whichever provider we've got. And that is a varying level of competent internet. I know one broadcaster that has been doing these sort of webinar things and has been auditing everyone's internet and paying for it to be upgraded if they can, to be able to get the best bandwidth possible so they can connect to these systems. And especially if we're talking the non sort of native SaaS models, the thin clients and very light programs, they're trying to cram a lot of data and a lot of throughput through a standard internet connection. And it's got to be at low latency as well. We're still talking about making production. So the moment you hit a button, you want it to cut. You want it to happen on the moment you're making that production. If you're going to hit a button, then it's going to happen a couple of seconds later. Is it suitable for broadcast? But the question is, are we doing what broadcast is at the moment? And I think that's where the question lies within these broadcasters trying to take on the what we can do, what is the minimum we can do, and trying to mold that together to make a broadcast. It's not necessarily the same rules we were playing with 6 months ago.
Carol, what are the other problems that you're seeing in the conversations that you're having with customers?
Often what I realize is that clearly they have had a lot of viewers, but a much less revenue in ads. So they're still producing a lot of content with less revenues. That has impacted a lot linear channels, I would say. So they're really trying to diversify and go on OTT, so everything on demand, to bring more revenues, because the ads one have been really... So the revenues for ads have been less important on television. So they're really looking at this diversification on OTT, service on demand, etc. So that's one of the things they're trying to figure it out, is producing that much content with so much less revenue compared to 6 months before. One of the other impacts is actually really pragmatic and rules, is that in control rooms now, you still need space between people. So this is something they need to reconsider, is that if they needed 10 people, now they cannot maybe fit in their control room because they need a decent distance between people. So these are all the new facts and rules they need to accommodate as well in the newsroom, in the control room. So they need to rethink the way they will produce the shows as well.
I've seen lots of hire spaces pop up out of this, and people are hiring a space to be their graphics area or their audio area, probably more on the sport side of things, where they are trying to remote to these sites coming up now. But they are trying to use these spaces in a way that they don't have to sit people next to each other. So they're expanding across their infrastructure wherever they can. And whole studio spaces are now complete control rooms, linked up with five other control rooms to make a single control room for a program. It's probably not that sustainable long term, but it's what they're having to deal with right now.
And Carol, you made a very interesting point earlier on, and I hadn't really thought about this, but I suppose more people working from home means more people actually consuming content as well as consumers. So you would think that the value of the ad space would increase. But of course, if you're stuck at home and you can't go out and buy anything, that doesn't really help, does it?
No, and we all thought that's great, so much more viewers. But the revenues has been really decreasing in most of the countries, at least what I've read. And we can really see OTT, SVOD, and all these were already, of course, well established before COVID. But it has clearly taken a different level right now, because people are really consuming on different platforms. And this is where television are trying really to find revenues, I believe, is to diversify their platforms.
You both talk on a regular basis to customers and partners, as I said right at the beginning there. In terms of, our relationship with customers and partners at the moment? I mean, how are things looking? What's the kind of state of the nation?
Well, a lot of our customers have been coming back to us to say, how can we use our tools in that remote way? And we've been helping them with that where we can. But I think as we come out of this this little bubble of pandemic, I think the future is now going to be, well, how do we prevent losing all our services again? There's been many stations that have sadly either suffered with COVID sufferers or have had to shut down in some places in the world. And obviously, news broadcast, it's a business at the end of the day. That's often a point that we forget. We all sort of after the story, after what we're trying to achieve, and it is a business at the end of the day, and we've got to keep those businesses going. Now, be it in a different format, but if you can be as close to the original format of what your business is and how it exists, that's always going to be beneficial to our customers, and we can help you do that.
Carol, what do you think? Are people feeling optimistic or pessimistic about the next 12 to 18 months?
That really depends, because so I work in EMEA in general. Really depends of regions. As I'm sure all of us read, it's not really well organized around Europe the same way. So some of them are really optimistic, especially, let's say, sport channels, the one producing content, where the countries have been able to start again, football, etc. They're really optimistic that things are going to move, especially from September. Everybody's talking about the fall to restart most of the things. Some other countries, it's still a bit blurry because of the political decision or other decisions. So it really varies between countries. But generally, we can feel that projects are restarting and everybody's really talking September, October. I think we're all waiting for the summer to pass and see what will bring us and what kind of rules will be implemented in each country. But we can see from the Nordics, the difference, like for example, then from UK. So these are, of course, these rules and are really impacting the way they're producing. So the projects in some countries, most of the projects have been postponed for 2021 out of security. So it's really case by case, country by country. I would say generally customers are, of course, staying positive, optimistic. On the side of the partners, I think we all feel it. It has been a lot of remote and I think an overload of information on their side of webinars. So they really appreciate more personal time where we can discuss proper projects and actually deliver specific content to them. A bit like what we do at IBCU NAB, but remotely. So they feel like they want more one-to-one conversation so they can really ask questions, for example. And of course, because we don't have IBC, that's something we will need to put in place more and more.
Yes, I don't think there's any doubt that a lot of partners out there will have lost a lot of business this year directly because of the pandemic. And I'm sure if things do pick up in the final quarter, they will be desperate to try and win as much business in that period as they can. Okay, I think we'll bring things to a close. Thank you both for your input today. It'll be interesting for us to try and get back together again towards the end of the year and just compare and see where we are come the fall, as you said, Carol. Thank you both again for your input. Thank you for joining us today, and we will be back with you with another Future Tech session soon. That's all for today. Thanks. Bye-bye.